Welcome to another episode of Gospel Gal. My name is Marissa and Amir, Gospel Gal. And today with me is Joy Dudley, the always joyful one. I also have Onnig Sayadian. Did I say that correctly?
Yes.
And Matthew Rosenblum.
Hello, it is Bloom.
Rosenblum. And they are from Back to the Reformation podcast. So we'll have an interesting conversation today. We're going to kind of go off the cuff, just kind of chat a little bit about where we are in life, physically, ecclesiastically, and spiritually. We've had some changes in our lives, I think all of us, within the last couple of years. So we just want to kind of catch up with everybody. So who wants to lead us off today? Who wants to share where they are physically so far?
Sure, I can start, but I'd like to say, Marissa, you pronounced my name so much better than Matt has ever pronounced it on any one of our shows.
Awesome. Thank you.
Just want to get that out there. So,
All right. Here's my co-host, Onnig Sayadian.
All right. Where am I? So physically, I live in Southern California. I guess I'll just give you my family life too. So married, I'll be 25 years next year. And we have 4 kids and 1 dog. Yeah. And so you asked physically, ecclesiastically, I attend Mount Ararat Bible Church in Northridge, California. A great church, a good Baptist confessional church, 1689. And spiritually, gosh, I don't know if we have enough time for spiritually. I'm much better where I am today than where I was 3 years ago, I can tell you that. Full assurance of faith, a greater desire to do the Lord's will because of the gospel and the assurance that the gospel brings. And so I'm just joyful. Yeah. And living the Christian life as a Christian should be living it.
Yeah. Well, thank you. You covered everything very quickly. Now we can wrap it up. I wanted to kind of just ask you a couple of questions about the physically and ecclesiastically. I can't even say the word. So this is a recent transition for you. You want to tell us a little bit about where you were coming from and the reason for the transition?
Sure. I mean, I'll reveal it. I came from Grace Community Church in Sun Valley, California. Yes, the Grace Community Church. Was a member there for quite a while, and I attended for 25 years. We pretty much grew up there. And as soon as we were married, we actually got baptized there, my wife and I, right before we got married. And everything was wonderful. Everything was fine and dandy, growing in the faith. And as far as, I was being taught, I knew I was a sinner, knew I needed Christ as a savior, was taught a Calvinistic soteriology as far as the dispensational camp can teach it. So because MacArthur did believe in the five solas of the Reformation, he did teach it, and he did a exemplary job doing that. But as time went on, something was wrong, right? Because we kept being taught to be introspective and to look at our walk and to examine ourselves constantly, consistently, and being challenged to surrender all to Christ, and so I failed miserably. And because of that, a lot of things occurred. I mean, I didn't have an assurance of my salvation. On another podcast, I mentioned this, that I was speaking to a friend. There was a certain point in time where I told him with full conviction that you don't really know you're saved, right? Only until at the end, if you've kept the faith, until you've persevered, we don't really know, right? And so that's how I believed, because of the theology of Lordship salvation was being taught there. And I guess you guys could possibly cover that later, but which taught basically that you have to test your faith by your walk, and pretty much strictly through your walk. And so it was detrimental to me, caused a lot of despair, until eventually I was introduced to the Reformed faith, understood the simultaneous nature of being a sinner and a saint, understood that our faith is founded on, it starts with our assurance, and that we live by the assurance of the object of our faith, who finished salvation for us, the Lord Jesus Christ. So I stopped focusing on myself and started focusing on Christ. And, it's like the scales fell off again. That's what it felt like. And so I was able to walk in newness of life, knowing that I do have a Savior that is pleased with me. So,
amen, praise the Lord.
Yeah, so we left Grace Church after that and attended Mount Ararat Bible Church, which is a Reformed Baptistic church. So I guess the Reformers would call them, what's that?
Irregular.
Particular Baptist.
Particular Baptist. Particular Baptist. Irregular, yeah, possibly. I would be the irregular Baptist in that congregation. So and it's been great. The engine of my sanctification is now the gospel, and it's been wonderful. Yeah. And the pastors there are also growing and understanding more and more of what the Reformed faith is, because we just adopted, when I say just, I think it's back 2.5 years ago, I just adopted the 1689 Confession of Faith, London Baptist Confession.
Yeah. Thanks for sharing that with us. I know that transitioning from Grace Community Church, which is more of a dispensationalist Calvinistic Baptist environment, and to where you are now was huge. So I'm thankful to hear that you are learning more and more to rest in Christ, and that's encouraging.
Yeah, amen. They are Calvinistic dispensational, Grace Community Church. And at the time when I was being fed Reformed theology, it was years before I was introduced to the proper view of assurance and such, but at the same time, I never held to a dispensational eschatology. I was always a covenantalist in that case. So,
oh, interesting.
Yeah, I felt out of place only because I had an influence with that friend of mine I told you earlier about, when I told him that we're not sure that we're saved until the end. He was Reformed, and so we talked a lot about covenantal theology.
Gotcha. Okay. So was he kind of instrumental in leading you to the place that you are now?
No, what was instrumental was Matt introduced me to, you know, that pastor up in the northeastern area of Florida. What's his name?
Does his name rhyme with John Fonville?
Yeah, it rhymes with John Fonville. Yes, it does. Yeah, and so I listened to an episode of, gosh, what was it?
Proclaim? The Theology Gals.
Theology Gals. Yes.
Oh, that famous episode. Yeah.
Theology Gals. I'm like, what is this pastor talking about? Come on, he's absolutely sure of his salvation. What is he talking about? And then he brought up scripture, and then he brought up the reasons why he believes that this is biblical. And I was taken back. It was just like being saved. Like for the first time.
Yes. It's like a lot of people say that it's like being born again.
Yeah, it was. And so that really led me to a proper soteriological view of salvation, of my faith.
Great. Well, so thank you for that too. Yeah. I mean, I think you kind of covered all three of those subcategories that I had: physically,
ecclesiastically,
and spiritually. Great. Who wants to go next? Where are you?
All right. This is Matt Rosenblum, and I am sitting here physically right next to Marissa in the mirror, and physically right next to Joy Dudley. And physically, I'm feeling a little bloated right now. I'm just kidding. But I am actually here in St. Augustine, Florida. I live currently in Jacksonville, Florida. Recently moved from Burbank, California, and lived here for about 5 months now, pretty much. And I am also the co-host with Onnig. I'm back to the Reformation, and I have a lovely wife, Roxana, and a daughter, Ava, who lives with us. And I have two other daughters, Savannah and Marlene is married. I've been a Christian since about 1992, 1993-ish. Got saved through the ministry of Calvary Chapel. And I was blessed for that. There were some great things that came out of that. However, I discovered the 5 points of Calvinism, and that ended that real quickly. And then I became part of a home church for 3 years, met my beautiful wife. Then we left that legalistic cult, and then became part of the PCA church, Presbyterian Church in America. We were there roughly for about 5 years. I was basically a new covenant, i.e. progressive covenantalist in a Presbyterian church. So I didn't hold to a covenant of works, covenant of grace, covenant of redemption, but I did hold to the continuity of the people of God. I was all millennial. I was a 5-point Calvinist, and I held to Lordship salvation. After that, we left for certain reasons, and then we became part of Sovereign Grace Ministries. We were there for 11 years. Not all people have had great experiences with Sovereign Grace Ministries, although we did. And we did learn a lot. Although at Sovereign Grace, there was a heavy emphasis, again, which was pietistic in nature. Although I have to say the people were not legalistic, but there was a lot of navel gazing. They were into people like John Piper, Wayne Grudem, all the Calvangelicals. And after a church split, the church was never the same. So it was time for Roxana and I to leave and leave somewhere else. And we were looking for basically somewhere that we could trust and someone who we could get fed under, who believed in the inerrancy of scripture, who didn't compromise. So we went to Grace Community Church for a year, where Onnig attended, and we sat under Pastor Johnny Mack, John MacArthur. We said we were going to try Grace Community Church for a year, and we did, and then we left. And we left for certain reasons. Number one, we sat under nuthetic counseling, and there was some rather weird stuff said. It sounded like Scientology, so we decided to bail. And while we were there, Roxana, my wife, one day while we're sitting under the teaching of Johnny Max said, "Babe, do you think that you can lose your salvation? Or do you believe that John MacArthur believes that we can lose your salvation?" And I thought, "No, babe, because he's a 5-point Calvinist." And I thought to myself, that's kind of weird, isn't it? Because you can kind of see the inconsistency, because the way he teaches it kind of sounds like you can lose your salvation, or you won't persevere to the end. And that almost that we're saved by our works, that our works are instrumental in nature rather than by grace through faith alone. Because he teaches justification by faith alone, and he can teach it rather beautifully as well. But there's an inconsistency there. And so that inconsistency started tugging at me, I should say. And then I was online in a Facebook group called Theocast. And I joined the Theocast Facebook group. And there I met this other Jewish gal sitting right next to me. Her name is Marissa Mark on Facebook. But she is gospel. But she's whispering, but she is the gospel gal. And so gospel gal basically started dialoguing with me. And she asked, "What's a nice Jewish boy doing in this podcast group?" And we got to dialoguing. And basically I was a Lordshipper. And I started asking questions. And she gave me a podcast episode to listen to after a while. And that was the podcast episode that you mentioned, Onnig, right? And that was with John Fonville.
Yep.
And that opened my eyes, and that just the curtains fell and the lights went on. And that's when I saw the law gospel distinction that was never taught to me, even during my PCA years, believe it or not, the law gospel distinction was not taught to me. I had heard it briefly through Michael Horton, because I was a fan of the White Horse Inn earlier, but I just ignored them because I thought that they were a little more looser in their living than someone like John MacArthur. And then I was on my journey, and then Onnig and I began this podcast, of course, because I became fully Reformed. And now I attend a church in Jacksonville, Florida, by the name of Paramount Church, and it's an Anglican church in the Anglican Church in North America. And we are a Reformed church who hold to the three forms of unity. We hold to the 39 articles, Book of Common Prayer, et cetera, et cetera. And we're blessed every Sunday to hear law and gospel.
And who's the pastor of that church?
Juanito Fonville, John Fonville.
His name rhymes with John Fonville? Wow, this is amazing.
What a coincidence. So,
what a coincidence.
What a quinkity. So that's my story, Marissa.
So where are you now? I mean, in terms of spiritually, ecclesiastically, I mean, I heard what you said about being at Paramount Church, but where are you in terms of like what you're believing now or what you're learning?
Okay, so what we're learning every Sunday is the gospel. The good news of Jesus Christ, the pure good news, what Jesus has done, not what we have done, but what he has done for us. And we're learning law and gospel. We get law and gospel every Sunday because you need to hear the law. You need to hear that you have broken God's commandments, and that drives you to the gospel. It keeps us on our feet. The law is a guide now. It's no longer a condemning thing that hangs over us. But I am also resting in Christ now, where I wasn't resting in Christ before, where I constantly navel gaze, and that would be my barometer of where my position was in Christ. But that is no longer the case. It is constantly gazing at him rather than gazing at my navel. And look, this is something we learn how to do more and more every day and every week. It's not easy after we've all been under law-centered preaching for so long. So, but I have a lot more assurance than I used to have. And I know it's the same for Onnig, and I know it's the same for you guys. Ecclesiastically, I am a Reformed Christian who is in an Anglican church. That's where I'm at right now. Can I say that I am a full-blown Anglican? Did I buy into everything as far as ecclesiology goes? No, but we all believe the same thing, other, you know, and everything else. So I don't have a problem at all. I love a lot of the things that the Anglican Church has to offer. I love the liturgy. And I'm more Presbyterian in my convictions as far as ecclesiology goes. But that's okay, because that's not the central issue. The central issue is, what is the gospel, and where is our authority? And the authority is Scripture itself. And then on top of that, and then basically behind that, I should say, are the Reformed creeds and confessions. Because we do honor the Belgic Confession, we do honor the Heidelberg Catechism, and we do honor the Canons of Dort, along with the 39 Articles. So this is where my home is, and we're blessed, and John is a faithful minister of the Word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Yep. Amen.
Boy Dudley, you're up.
So it's my turn now? Okay. Yes. All right. Okay, so where am I physically? So physically, I am currently in St. Augustine, Florida with Marissa, and I'm having a blast, and she's just been such a wonderful and kind host this time. Right now, I'm in Southern California. I am single, and I'm ready to mingle. Just kidding, you can block that out. So if anyone out there is looking for a Reformed gal... JK.
Could be a catch. Go get her.
Where was I? I think I lost my train of thought. I'm single. I live in SoCal. I live with my mom and my sister. And yeah, I work from home. I also have a cat. So there's really nothing that interesting about me at all.
You do a great podcast.
Yes, that. I always have fun doing the podcast with Marissa. So it's really fun. So ecclesiastically, I am a member of a URCNA congregation in Southern California. It's called Christ Reformed Church. So if any of you are familiar with Dr. Kim Riddlebarger, he was the former pastor of that church before retiring. I enjoy being in the URCNA. It's a lot more structured than what I am used to, being coming from an evangelical background, but there are things about the church's liturgy that I really love. So the liturgy always has the law and the gospel. The gospel is kind of interplayed throughout the entire service. So you can, if you hear it after the laws in law, we confess our sin, we hear the absolution, and then you can also hear it in the pastoral prayer. We hear it in the liturgy when we do communion every Sunday. So it's just one of those things that I really appreciate about my church, going through long gospel. And even in the sermons, of course, sermons are always like good long gospel sermons for the most part. Let's see, where am I spiritually? Right. So spiritually, I have more assurance. I think going into or learning more about the confessions, Reformed soteriology, long gospel, that was a very hard transition for me. It was very hard for me to leave my prior church because of that. But I'm not sitting there questioning my salvation 24/7. So that's a huge trade-off. I was influenced a lot by Lordship, Salvation, and John MacArthur's ministry. I think there were two episodes that were pivotal for me in being able to determine what exactly was wrong. One was, obviously, the Theology Gals episode with John Fonville, with Dr. John Fonville, which after hearing that for the first time, I was mad.
You were angry.
I was angry about it because he was calling out all of my favorite teachers. But, you know, after a while, you kind of just let it settle. And then the second one was Leaving Pietism by Theocast. That one was really, really, really something that resonated with me was because of the way they described what it was like being in Pietism and what it's like leaving. And it was something that was really resonating for me because it was something, even though I was very grateful for being able to find rest in Christ for the law gospel distinction, there was also an element of anger and grief and sadness, just, and, you know, wondering if, you know, if I was wrong about this my entire Christian life, what else am I wrong about? And where's my foundation? And I think being at my church now, it's been really good with rebuilding the foundation and rebuilding where the emphasis of the Christian life should be, which always should be in Christ. And I remember I think MacArthur had a sermon on the Shepherd's Conference that talked about in which he told some of the pastors that you should always be leading your congregation into this constant self-inventory of your spiritual life. And I just remember thinking, yep, that's exactly what I did. I was always constantly looking at myself, didn't really have much room for, you know, other people or looking at other people or loving my neighbors, because that's what we're called to do as Christians, to love God and love our neighbors. But you can't really do that if you are constantly navel-gazing. So I guess where I'm at now spiritually is, I'm still learning more about law and gospel. I'm trying, you know, I'm with going and attending to the means of grace, with receiving the word and the sacrament, the knowledge of Christ is something that grows as we, you know, live our lives and, are saturated in good, really sound, good, law and gospel preaching. And, you know, another aspect of law and gospel that has helped me was kind of learning more about who I am as a person. Cause you know, under pietism and under lordship, there were a lot of aspects about my personality that I kind of suppressed because I didn't think they were godly, but now learning more about law and gospel and understanding the freedom that I have in Christ, I don't feel the need to constantly question all of my motives. I don't feel the need to constantly question like how I'm interacting with people. I can just be like who I am and just love people the way that God calls me to love people without second guessing it. So I think one of the, another influence that I had was White Horse Inn, and one of my, they quoted John Calvin where he said, all of our, motives are impure, but they're swallowed by the purity of Christ. So why not get going and doing good works? Even though we know that all of our works are still tainted by sin, they're always covered by the righteousness of Christ, and that we are always relating to God based on Christ's active obedience to the law in our place. And our lives are hidden in Christ. And, you know, those things, they sound very heavy and theological, but they're very practical because, you know, like, we're not relating to God based on our sin anymore. We're defined by Christ's life. And that's just pretty good. Some pretty good truth right there. So
it's amazing truth.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Thank you for that. So Marissa, your turn.
So Marissa, it is your turn. Where are you physically, ecclesiastically, and spiritually?
So just like you and Matthew, I am sitting in my breakfast room in St. Augustine, Florida. We moved here after following and being mentored really by John Fonville through the internet. For about 7 years, we ended up in a position where we could move here, and we're just so thankful to actually be here. We have a great community of friends and our church is I hope it's growing. It is small right now because of the impact that COVID had on our church. And so we're in a growing process right now, which is good. Ecclesiastically, I would say that I am becoming more and more of a Reformation Anglican. I do, as others have said, love the liturgy of our church. I love that there is always a reminder of the weight of the law. We're always reminded week after week that we are, it is our duty to love God and love neighbor. And each week we say to that, Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Because when we're faced with that reality, it's weighty. I love that after we hear that word, we're assured. Of sacramentalism, that it is in baptism and communion that we are, that is in Anglicanism, that we are reminded in the sacraments of the gospel every time, not what we're doing, not what we're bringing, but what Christ is bringing to us, what Christ is, how Christ is serving us in those, just really encouraging. So, yes, I'm a member at Paramount Church. And I think, you know, as people ask me questions about spiritual things, one of the things that seems to always present itself is, what are you doing as compared to what has Christ done and what is he doing for you? Right. That's just so, so vitally important that we have a grasp. It is not, we don't bring anything for justification besides our sin. Mm-hmm. That's what makes it necessary. We don't bring anything to sanctification either. It's what Christ is doing and how the Holy Spirit is working in us. And I think it's just so helpful to remember and to realize that the imperatives of Scripture are promised to us. I mean, these are things that eventually will get perfect in the not yet. Mm-hmm. We're living in the already, so we don't do these things perfectly, but eventually, because of the grace of God in Christ, we'll be glorified and those things will be realities all the time. But in the process, we're just assured that the Lord, he gives us salvation and then he gives us good works to do, right?
Amen.
Yep.
So we can, and those good works are not for us to boast in. They're gifts of God also, and they benefit our neighbors. So I don't know. Those are a few things that, you know, I just think about on a regular basis. So that's kind of where I am spiritually, but resting in Christ at the same time.
All right, so this is a question for all of you. What aspect about the gospel is bringing you the most comfort in your season of life right now?
I think there's two aspects to it. Number one, substitution, that he's become a substitute in my place, and that I don't have to do anything else to merit my salvation. When it comes to my standing before God, I think that it's really interesting too to think about, there's also an aspect of Christus Victor, that he has done it all, that he is victorious over all evil, especially that Satan is bound, mm-hmm. and that we are protected in a way that we weren't before, right? And just trusting that. It's I've been really thinking about a lot about spiritual warfare recently, because there's been a lot of talk, and, you know, we see a lot of oppression that goes on right now for Christians. And I know my own life in certain ways, and how the enemy can really bring it on. So I've just been really focusing on that aspect of it as well, to Christus Victor. And there's, you know, of course, there's many sides to the atonement, there's many aspects. And, you know, just, I love to dwell on the cross in general, you know, that his righteousness is given to us, and it's a credit to us on our behalf, and that we don't have to do anything anymore. And that's what motivates us, as you were saying, Marissa, mm-hmm. unto good works. Yeah. So that's where I'm at.
I would say that one of the things, one of my most, I don't know how to say it. You were asking what do you love most about the gospel, or what's the most meaningful part of the gospel?
Yeah, I guess like what aspect about the gospel is giving you the most comfort in your season of life right now?
Well, I think risen Christ. Yeah. Risen Christ is our mediator. So I think I was talking to you about that Thomas Goodwin book. I'll paraphrase because I can't quote him directly, but basically he's saying, I mean, in all of our backgrounds, I think we had this perception that yes, God saves us, that Christ, you know, Christ died, Christ was buried, Christ was risen. We understand the gospel, the facts of the gospel, but then somehow when we sin, God's angry with us. Like a displeased father, just waiting, you know, he's just waiting for us to do something wrong so he can be angry and turn his back on us. And that is so not who Christ is. That's not who God the Father is. Christ, part of his humanity was meant to feel the weight of sin. Not that he did sin, but that he was tempted in every way, like we are tempted. So Christ in heaven now still has that same body. He has a resurrected body that is in heaven. And Christ still remembers the pain and the agony of being tempted. Mm-hmm. So when we are tempted, he feels compassion for us. And that is so meaningful to me, to have Christ in heaven seeing me tempted and not being disgusted with me, but instead feeling pity and compassion and love and interceding for me at the same time.
Some good stuff right there.
So the gospel's a good psychological remedy then,
right?
It can be. Christ touches, I mean, you're being sarcastic.
No,
I think,
I'm not being sarcastic. I mean, it's seriously.
It's true.
I mean, you know, people talk about, you know, going to a psychologist, and I'm not against going to a psychologist, but if you want a good psychological session, really, I mean, gaze at the gospel, right? Preach the gospel to yourself. I mean, that's the best psychology you can get, really, right? I mean.
Well, that's real healing.
Yeah.
There's nothing fluffier or fake. It's not fake news. It's good news.
Right.
It's real.
I really do mean that. I mean, you know, I mean, yes, yeah. I'm for therapy, but that the best, but the
real
best,
medicine,
the best medicine of all is the gospel. Yep.
Yeah. Well, he says he's the great physician, right? That could be mentally or spiritually.
You know, the gospel heals all sorts of wounds.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Wounds of
so how about you, Onnig?
Yeah. Oh, well, I think the first thing that came to my mind was in regards to what aspects of the gospel is Christ as mediator. And knowing that, and this is something that I'm still learning and just in awe and understanding through the Reformed faith, that as Christ being mediator, he's mediator as it says in 1 Timothy 2, right? There's one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. And being specifically the man Christ Jesus, it speaks of his nature as a human being, as a substitutionary atonement. So that is helping me in such a practical way, because it then reminds me of my union with Christ, right? Christ in me, and I in Christ. So, and being in Christ is like you take refuge in him from, you know, the world, Satan, and all the powers and principalities of the air and all that, and also from yourself, right? Your own sins. And it's like being in a nice cozy house while it's raining and pouring outside, but you know you're safe inside. And so it's that, and it all comes from that aspect of the assurance that you attain from knowing a true gospel and focusing on the object of your faith, the Lord Jesus. So yeah, that's been very helpful for me.
Okay, so apparently I have to answer my own question. But anyway, I've noticed the theme with the three of you guys as Christ being our mediator. And I was just reminded of this, of the Belgic Confession, Article 26, about Christ's intercession. So I'm not going to read the whole thing because it's kind of long, but I am going to read some, just a part of it that was really comforting for me. And it says, "We believe that we have no access unto God, but alone through the only mediator and advocate, Jesus Christ, the righteous, who therefore became man, having united in one person the divine natures, that we men might have access to the divine majesty, which access would otherwise be barred against us. But this mediator, whom the Father has appointed between him and us, ought in no wise to affright us by his majesty, or cause us to seek another according to our fancy. For there is no creature, either in heaven or on earth, who loveth us more than Jesus Christ, mm-hmm. who, though he was in the form of God, yet made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a man and of a servant for us, and was made like unto his brethren in all things. If then we should seek for another mediator, who would be well affected toward us, whom could we find? Who loved us more than he, who laid down his life for us, even when we were his enemies? And if we seek for one who hath power and majesty, who is there that has so much or both as he who sits at the right hand of his Father, and who hath all power in heaven and on earth? And who will sooner be heard than the Son, and who will sooner be heard than the own well-beloved Son of God?" So in answering to my question, there's two aspects about the gospel. Definitely the mediator, Christ being our mediator, and everything that it entails. I remember on Lord's Day, we were going through the article in the Apostles' Creed about Christ being descended into hell, which you can go into all sorts of caveats. But my main point is that from the moment Jesus was conceived, he was already suffering because mm-hmm. he left his heavenly glory to become man. And that suffering culminated into him being crucified and absorbing the wrath of the Father and him obeying the law. And just thinking about everything that entails. And then him being our mediator in heaven and interceding for us and praying for us. Like, I mean, I can't imagine what it would be like to hear Christ praying for us by name. Mm-hmm. And then God being pleased to answer his own beloved Son. Like, who else would we turn to? Why would we even bother turning to anyone else besides Christ? Because of everything that he is and everything that he's done for us. So that's one aspect about the gospel that's comforting to me. And the second one is just dealing with the resurrection as a historical and objective truth. that really hit home for me, because again, when we're living our Christian life, when we think about sanctification, we think about, you know, living a life that's pleasing to the Lord. It's really easy to slip into that legalistic mindset, into thinking that it's, that we are alone in that endeavor. But looking back objectively to what Christ has done for us, that he was raised from the dead, that our sanctification is grounded in that too. Like, our sanctification is a done deal. It's not something that is left to us to do on our own. Like, we, first of all, we're passive recipients of it. And secondly, any good that we do is from the hand of God. So we are indebted to God for even the good works that we do. And that aspect is really comforting to me too, because of course, like, there are times where we all fall short. We all fall short of the glory of God. We're reminded of it constantly whenever we read the law and we hear the law preached, and we're constantly going back to the gospel in repentance and in faith and asking Christ to forgive us of our sin. And that, I mean, sometimes you're like repenting to God for the same thing like three times a day, and it's like, really? I keep falling short of this. Did you really do this? But when we think about the resurrection, we know and understand that our sin and our failures and our darkness and our suffering doesn't even have the last word over our lives. It's Christ's life that has the last word. The resurrection is the last word for us. So that's pretty incredible.
Yes.
Yeah.
All I can say is, Onnig, I give up. This is your new co-host right here, Joy Dudley. Yeah, I want to say this young lady right here can articulate doctrine and theology like no one else. Seriously, for those of you who are listening, Joy is a very talented writer, and I would recommend you guys reading her blog. What's your blog?
It's called Eternally Assured.
Yeah, I mean, anything, Marissa and her are something else. They're quite a team, and Marissa has done quite a job of discipling this young lady, and we're seeing the fruits of her labor for sure.
You know,
thank you, God. I don't think I can take credit for that, but thank you for saying that.
I gotta say something about something you said, Joy, about having to manufacture some version of yourself because it felt inappropriate when you were in like an lordship environment. I think Matt and I talked about something like that, something similar to that. What did you call it, Matt? Spiritual weirdness, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. It reminds me of that topic, spiritual weirdness, like pretending to be, oh, brother, how are you today? Oh, sister, you know, something to the effect of kind of manufacturing a version of yourself that you're really not, a personality that you're really not. And that's what I remembered. So, and also what you said, Joy, about sanctification. Yeah, so we're buried with Christ, right? And we rise with him as well. And I think Michael Horton said that when our burial with Christ refers to our sanctification and, you know, rising up with him refers to our sanctification, how it's his work. That's a wonderful thing.
Amen. Yes. So does anybody have anything else to add as we close? Any closing remarks?
I am wearing a brand new Bucky's Hawaiian shirt.
Awesome. Do I see like Woody's, the cars, like those Woody
yes.
Station wagons?
That's awesome, man.
They're cute.
There's Bucky right there.
Nice.
Did you get that when you were here in Jacksonville?
Yeah.
Or St. Augustine?
That's one I got from St. Augustine. I have another one I got from Daytona.
Oh, wow. Nice.
Daytona Beach.
So now you just have to actually like haul your family down here and live down here. Joy too. Got to make Floridians out of all of you.
Yeah, I'm trying.
Well, I'm grateful for all of you. Thank you for what you had to add to this conversation today. We love the church chats with Gospel Gals. Good stuff. I think we might have some of the resources that we mentioned today in the episode notes, so you can check that out when I post post this to the YouTube channel. And I hope we can do this again. It's encouraging. I'm thankful for my brothers and my sisters in Christ.
Well, we're grateful for you. You know, Nick and I are appreciative of you having us on here.
Yeah, it was fun.
Oh, where can we find your podcast, guys?
And Onnig, where can you find, where can I find our podcast?
You can find us at, you can find us at bttrmin.org. That's our website. Our podcast is aired on Apple, Google, Stitcher, Spotify, YouTube, and many others that is part of some conglomeration that is pushed out. But in any case, so you can email us at info@bttrmin.org as well, or backtothereformation@gmail.com.
We also have a Facebook page. So if you want to go on our Facebook page, you can find information there, and we post stuff here and there.
Yeah, if you want to argue with us on Twitter too, we have a Twitter, Twitter
handle. There's always that.
Yeah.
Joy, I think we need Onnig to be like our manager or something. They're like everywhere. That'd be cool. All right, you guys, thank you for joining another episode. Watch out for some more episodes as well.
I have come back to your broken table, and my body bears this trouble. Take me home, take me back to my beginning, before the hell and that set in and I came to this portal. Take me home.